CosmicRadio.TV. Did not fill. Welcome to another fine edition of my so-called 8-Bit Life. I'm your host, Roberto Vaz. Joining me today, I guess, lead guy? Lead dev?
Well, it's kind of funny. Like, I call myself the creative director because, like, okay. Oh, I've always wanted to be one of those.
Okay, creative director of the now official Rooster Teeth published game, Battlesloths.
Yep.
Phillip Johnson. How's it going, sir?
It's been pretty good. We just got out of... You know, we just had a nice PAX South where we announced the game last week. Well, that would be like in a publishing agreement with Rooster Teeth Games.
Yeah, the first game that's not based on one of their own properties.
Yeah, essentially, like
I mean, technically, it's the first game being published by them. If you don't count Ruby Grim Eclipse, but
we would be considered the first indie that is published under that brand,
which is insane. It's so crazy because I was thinking back before this interview how it is that we met.
Yep,
and
I was drunk.
Yes, you
and,
were.
And there was this radio show going on at a bar.
Because it was such funny, because if I think about a lot of times when I meet, guests or developers, it's usually through a friend of mine. Like, in the case we had Ted on, or it was because of you. You'd said, hey, there's this guy that's working a game. And I was like, cool, I'd love to talk with him. And if it's, like, a friend of Richard, somebody else like that, it's usually that. But you, I happen to be at Mr. Tramps. Mr. Tramps. It's this weird English bar here in Austin, Texas.
It's very common for game dev meetups there.
Yeah, I never realized how common it was to have like that, like, kind of shit go down
there. Once every 2 weeks, probably.
Yeah. And so I was there helping a friend of mine with his podcast, specifically Chris Cox. He does his own thing there on I think oneofus.net or .com. I forget the
I never
site.
Got to hear that podcast.
Neither have I. So don't, you know, it's
between, I have no idea how to find it.
It's in the ether. And I will, and again, I'm not their developer. I'm not their producer or anything like that. I was just there because Chris knew I did better. You know, I worked on my own podcast and I had figured out audio and he had a lot of trouble with it, getting the audio source. So I was like, fine, I can figure this out. And I figured it out in about a few minutes. But then, they start talking about movies or whatever, and somehow you heard. Talk from your perspective of this, because I always find this from yours more fascinating than mine.
Okay, so, well, first off, I was drunk, and that's not something you should aspire to be, kids. So don't.
Isn't that the common thread between like that's a thread I hear between every indie developer.
Right, these guys were doing this podcast, and I was thinking like, it didn't sound like they had a guest, or they sounded like they were just kind of reading headlines. So I was thinking, like, well, I'm an interesting person, probably. And I just kind of grabbed a napkin from the bar, and I wrote, hi, my name is Phillip. I made a game called Battlesloths, and it's sloths killing each other for pizza. And I just kind of slipped it under the table. And I said, I'll be on, I'll be on the show if you guys want me to.
Yeah.
And then the guy was like, hey, stick around. Like, we'll have you on in, like, 5-10 minutes. And then I came on, and... I forget what we did, though. Oh, they asked me to sing the rap song at that point.
And you had showed the trailer for it, or I guess at that point.
No, I wasn't able to show the trailer, but I think...
You showed something, because we saw pictures of sloths and shooting.
Was there, like, a display there? I just remember that, like, we just had mics, and that was it.
Maybe that was it. Maybe you didn't show anything. Maybe you showed me afterward.
They asked me to do some lyrics from the Middle Claws Up single that Michael Kill and them had done for us.
Right.
And so I was happy to oblige.
And so what's funny is, like, I heard about this. I go, okay, cool. This sounds interesting. And after the show, Chris and them were kind of hanging out. We were hanging out. Mm-hmm. And I started asking more about the game, because this is like, one, it's an indie game, two, I love talking to developers and figuring whatever. You showed me some clips or something, because I remember seeing at that point.
Yeah, I probably got my phone out.
Right. I was like, this looks even more interesting. Or I looked it up. Like, I think what it was, I looked it up. I saw it and I said, oh, okay, I'm really intrigued. Because I was like, okay, cool. Guy working on this. Interesting. And I go, wow, this looks really interesting. This looks like a bizarre game. This looks a little silly, a little funny. Has some interesting notes to it, And then we start talking more afterwards. And I mention, you know, I have a friend of mine who also works on kind of stuff like that. Richard Cook. You're like, oh, yeah, he worked on the game. He worked on the game. And I was like, oh, shit. Maybe this is why it sounds kind of familiar, because Richard might have tweeted about this.
Yeah,
and Rich, it's just like a small fucking world.
Rich had joined us for doing some UI art. And
yeah,
he
exactly.
Did, he helped us with the trailer, too.
Right. It was just such a weird kind of thing. Just like, oh, wait, that's right. He did it. It was such a weird how everything connected that point in time.
Yeah, I thought it was kind of weird too, but it didn't really surprise me that much.
I mean, it doesn't either. That it was like, oh yeah, of course. But it was just such a interesting thing of like, here I am at this point that, and then flash forward to now, you know, because
it's a lot of stuff has happened.
Well, because between then and now, at every convention I've been at, and I think this is the more interesting, you know, the most endearing thing about you as a person and you as sort of a pitch guy, if you will, mm-hmm. is that at every convention I've been at, big or small, you've been there in some capacity.
Yeah, I'm just everywhere.
Well, I mean, that's important. I think that's the most important thing.
It's kind of like a necessity, because there's just no one else is going to show the game.
Well, because then I think that's what's kind of cool, is that like it wasn't that I saw you always at... I wouldn't be like, oh, I saw you at PAX. It's like, no, I saw you at PAX, like RTX. You were at MAGFest this past time. You've been at Juegos. You've been at all these sort of – anywhere that will let you show the game, you will show the game. And anywhere that let you play – you know, allow
– Oh, yeah, show it at bar. Like,
yep.
I don't care. Like,
And that's, I think, what has kind of endeared me to you over the time, because I've met, you know, devs and had the chance of talking with them. But you – it's become this sort of like – anywhere that I've seen you, I'm not saying you're always pitching the game. It's like, hi, I'm Phil. I make Battlesloths. You know,
it's
you're not like
kind of nice, because it's kind of easy to explain. And so, like, I usually don't have to say a whole lot before people get kind of a picture of what the game is.
Well, let's start from the beginning, because you know, as we tend to do in the show, we like to look forward before we go. You know, we got to go backwards before we go forwards.
That's right.
So. When did Battlesloths begin its life? Like, how did it begin its life? How did you land on Sloths?
Okay, so I guess it was like probably like 2 or 3 years ago, and I was having trouble sleeping, and so like I kind of, as a result, I kind of ended up having like a fascination with sloths. It's kind of almost like a jealousy thing. Like, I want to be a sloth. I want to sleep like a sloth. And then I just discovered how like ridiculously cute they were. So I just would like go on Google image search and just like look at pictures of sloths. And then that was kind of it. I did have an idea for like a mobile game where it would be about like trying to become like the slowest sloth, and you start off as really fast. And
oh, that'd be interesting.
And then you had to like do things like play Secret Roast Records at 1 RPM or something to like. I can relax and.
Oh my god! I love the idea. I love the idea of a sloth playing a 45 or a 33.
It was supposed to be like an inverted, like an inverse of like Cookie Clicker, where
yeah.
instead of clicking it all the time, you try to not click on it.
Oh man, that's.
And so
interesting.
Like that was just a game idea we never had done. I never like did anything with it. I guess I tried to make like some sort of like prototype with it, but it was just kind of like I couldn't get any excitement around it. This game jam had popped up, and I had asked a few of my buddies. I said, hey, can you guys want me to I would like it if you guys would let me be the creative director. I'm a UI programmer. I'm not
right.
a designer or a director or a producer or anyone that would really have ever been given any sort of leadership. And so
much like everybody else in the creative
pretty much.
Creative designer position.
So like they agreed to it, and I had like a pet project idea that I wanted to do about kind of like a rock and roll musician who would kind of fight aliens in another dimension after his like rock concerts, and it was kind of like a David Bowie sort of deal.
I now want that game, not because I like Battlefloss, but that
I
just
mean,
sounds
I,
like
I keep that idea alive in like a different form. I don't know if it'll be a video game though.
That's okay.
I want to do something else with it.
Even then, I would love the idea of just like, thank you, Boston. Good night.
Yeah.
All right. Now it's time to time to suit up and just.
Yeah,
like,
that's basically what the idea was. Is that he would be like doing a concert, and then he would go to another dimension and fight aliens, but then like he would be talking about it in the public eye.
Just ELO so playing in the background.
Well, yeah, he would have like this kind of like Kanye West level of controversy around him because he's just always running his mouth about like insane stuff. So like I couldn't really like get any excitement around it. But there was this like Yes End session where he said, "Can we add Sloths and Pizza?" This is like two artists that were friends of mine.
It's like, yeah, sure, why not?
Yeah, Andy Foltz and Jacob Huff. And so I was like, yeah, sure. So I didn't have any artists on my game jam. So I was right. Just like, okay, well, these guys might walk if I don't put Sloths and Pizza in the game.
Yeah.
And so then it was about a rock and roll sloth who runs a slice of pizza to another dimension and fights aliens. Okay, so this idea wasn't very good.
It's okay. He's still it's beginning, and that's, you know, like it's the kernel of what will become.
We had written like I made this game design doc for it, and it was just kind of like three games in one, and it was just kind of a mess. So, basically, I tossed the whole thing out, and I could tell that like the people in the game jam team were thinking it wasn't like it was too complicated, and it was kind of getting lost in a bunch of nonsense. It wasn't like a very functional like premise for a game jam.
Right.
So I kind of killed that, and then there was the kind of the sloths and the pizza kind of in my peripheral. I was like thinking like, well, okay, well, these guys want sloths and pizza. I wasn't going to make that something that it was going to be absolutely have to be in the game or whatever. But you know, I just kind of kept that in mind. So I guess recently during that time I just played like Hotline Miami, and I'm a huge fan of Samurai Gun.
Yes. Yeah,
party game.
Samurai Gun was especially at Fantastic Arcade for years before mm-hmm. it came out, was like a staple there.
Yeah, it's a fucking awesome game.
Such a fun game. And, so much fun.
At one point I ended up meeting Dose One, the rapper.
Oh really?
And it turned out he had worked on that game, and I was like, oh, shit. Like,
yeah, no, Samurai Gun's such a fun – it's one of those games that, like, we've played – like, I played many times. I owned a copy of it. It's definitely, like, one of my go-to, like, if I have people here mm-hmm. and more than four, I'm like, guys, we'll play Samurai Gun? What's that?
Yeah, that game's amazing.
Wait till we play it.
I would love for them to make, like, a futuristic, like, Hyperlight Drifter-style sequel.
That'd be fun. That'd be really
cool. It turns out I was, like, wondering – I was kind of bummed. I was like, what happened to that team? I found out later that a lot of those guys went to go work on Hyperlight Drifter.
Oh, okay. Well, that answers everything then.
So I think I would love to see them do like a futuristic update where it's like maybe they I guess I should keep this to myself in case they wanted to use this idea. But I think they should do like a kind of Neo Tokyo like futuristic.
Oh, yeah. No, I think that would be great. Again, hearing that they worked on Hyperlight, that answers a lot more questions on Hyperlight.
I think people would be more ready for it now. But if you look at the Steam Spy, it was not too many sales for Samurai Gun.
Well, because Samurai Gun was that weird. Like, what was interesting about that game, is that if you knew about it, you wanted to buy it. It never hit sale. It never really got any kind of push by anybody. It just sort of existed.
Yeah.
And if you know about the game, you're like, oh yeah, this is the jam.
Yeah, it's an awesome game.
And when you introduce it to people, like, this is the jam, and it becomes like, it's time to play. It's like Nidhogg. Like Nidhogg never had any kind of like hardcore push.
Mm-hmm.
But if you were in the scene and you got introduced to Nidhogg, everyone kind of just sort of found it organically. At least that's the way it felt for me.
Yeah, a lot of people always ask me, like, it's like, oh, were you a big fan of Towerfall and other games? And I was kind of, to be honest, it was Samurai Gun. It was the game that inspired.
That makes me happy because I'm a fan of Samurai Gun. This is a Samurai Gun household, as they say.
I always get a whole bunch of people addicted to that game.
Samurai Gun.
And Hotline Miami.
Right.
That's the game I say we should try to make something like that. So it's just a top-down Hotline Miami like party game.
And that's why I immediately, when I finally got to play the game, because it wouldn't have been until, I don't
probably
remember.
Probably like RTX?
Probably RTX, that I actually got to sit down and play it, because that was like the last convention I went to that had it. And you're like, yeah, here's the game. I go, cool. What was funny is that like right around there was Minor Key Game showing off Gunmetal Arcadia.
Yeah, those guys are cool.
Oh yeah, I forget the guy's name, and I feel
Kyle
bad.
Pittman.
Yeah, Kyle Pittman. Thank you. Hi, Kyle. Like, Kyle's because Kyle's been on the show before, and he's a great guy, and he's also another friend of mine. My friend Charles is a friend of his and a fan of his as well. And you know, it was right there by Kyle. So like, cool. It's like, oh, cool. Battlesloths. I got to finally get a chance to finally play this game, and. It was one of those games that, I mean, thankfully we're in a point in time where you know, for me at that point, I was already getting back into twin stick shooters because at that point I had either it was still in develop, I guess it was still in development at that time, and it was the early release, the early edition copy of Vlambeer's Nuclear Throne.
Yeah, that kind of informed the art style for our game, actually.
Yeah, well, because it knows exactly what kind of game it is, and I mean, and you know, Rami and team.
Yeah, Nuclear Throne's cool.
It's such a good game. But because of that, I was already kind of used to that control style, because I get immediately you put a controller in my hand, it's twin stick. I'm like, all right, cool. Or it fires triggers, cool. And it became this sort of like super intuitive control scheme.
Yeah, I mean, like simplicity is kind of like the best way to design a party game around. Like, I am not even good at Smash Brothers. I think Smash Brothers is too complicated for me.
Wow, okay. Interesting.
But
okay.
Battlesloths is a hard game, but the core mechanics are like super, super easy.
Well,
to pick up.
I think that's what I liked about it was that it was this very, and even I, you know, even in later times, we've had the luck of streaming it here during our extra live stream because you've had, you know, you've come over.
Yeah, I think I had the dodge roll by then.
Right, exactly. Had a couple of things and other mechanics added to it, but even at that point, we didn't have to tell anybody how to play it.
You know, I'm a super soft spoken guy. So, like, I feel like if I get the UI in the right place, then I don't have to tell anybody how to play the game. And that makes my life easier.
Well, because it was so funny.
Like, I never lose my voice at conventions.
Well, because it was so funny was that, like, at RTX, and this is the reason why I bring it up, is that you guys, you know, it was like you, Richard.
And Courtney and Randy.
Right. You're just kind of hanging out there, and people are playing the game. Next to you, and I don't even know what game this is. This tells you how much I forget.
To our left was Clash Cups, who are the really cool guys from Virginia, I think.
What was the really hyper, crazy, colorful, anime-esque looking game, like puzzle? Was that Clash Cups, I guess? I guess it was.
You're talking about Jack-Jack?
I guess Jack-Jack was the game.
Okay. Because
I honestly forgot about that game until you told me.
Yeah, I played a little bit of that.
But what was interesting to me is that I looked at that game.
Uh-huh.
I kind of got it was a puzzle game. I don't quite know how you played it, and I still couldn't understand the color switching.
I found it difficult to understand too, but when I played it, I was like 3 days into the convention.
Right.
And I was totally beat.
No, but even I watching it was like, this looks interesting. But the parallel, and this is why I brought it up, was that anybody that came by your booth, and it was there was a lot of traffic, you know, there's a good amount of traffic, you know, especially which made me happy as a friend, never had a question on what the concept of your game was.
I would, I look at their face and their hands, and then I just let them play, and then if they look like they don't know how to aim, I'd be like, aim at the right stick.
Yeah.
Because they might not play twin stick shooters.
Right, for sure.
And then I'll talk about the hoverboard, and then just say, kill the other sloths and take pizza back to your base, and that's kind of it. We didn't have the dodge roll then. So
right,
that
but it was just such
really
a – it was so – it was like you had hit the nail on the head for the UI. Did it take you a few tries to kind of get the
character screen is still like needs work, but I spent a lot of time trying to smooth out that experience. But the game like UI and like the game UI, like when you get into the match and stuff, there's only one thing, and it's basically just your score on the pizza. We used to have like a bar at the bottom, and we're just like, well, no one's ever gonna look at that, and so we just put it on the pizza. And then that kind of made us have to enforce that every game mode could only track one idea.
Yeah.
So like, there's slices or how many lives you have, or
which I think is the best thing to do for those kind of party games. Like you mentioned, even though you had not been aware of it, like Towerfall has those sort of ideas where it's that. If you think
right.
of like, there's a porcupine. I don't even know the.
Yeah, I've never actually got to play like too much. Towerfall multiplayer,
right? The same idea, like that. Samurai Gun, for example, you know, it's based on 10 kills and you win kind of thing. There's you know, environmental deaths, and even in your game, there's some environmental
hazards.
Yeah, we have
the death matches and stuff, and well, we put a lot of environmental stuff in because you know, we have like very small levels. We used to have like camera zoom and stuff, but it was just.
I think that.
It was confusing people.
For party games, I think the smaller levels are the better.
Well, yeah, but because the levels are so small, that's why we had to make hazards, because otherwise everything would be exactly the same.
Well,
because
it becomes, you know, feel free to talk about the challenge of this, especially when it comes to a party game, because like one of the things for that game type that I think is hard to compensate for, and why you keep it on single screen, is making sure that everybody knows who they are.
That's still a challenge. Like if it weren't for the two players, like if they have the same, if they're on the same team, and they don't have a different hat, then I could see them getting confused. feel like we haven't really solved that issue yet.
So I think we should you know, stop burying the lead here. We keep talking about I think one of the most unique features of this game, because it was
Hats.
Because that was like day
one. I can get back to like the genesis of the game and talk about the hats too.
Go for it. Yeah,
was in the
let's
game
get back.
Jam,
let's
so
flash back more.
All right, so let's see. I was kind of back in my apartment in Cary, and it was the Hotline Miami meet Samurai Gun. And then I was thinking, like, okay, well, what's it going to be about? And then I was like, okay, well, sloths, they're sloths, and they drop pizza when they die. And that was it.
It's
and
okay.
Then I was like, it doesn't matter if they're fast or slow, like, who cares? They're battle sloths.
Yes.
And
they're battle sloths.
Yeah, I just laughed for like 5 minutes. And then
it's such a fucking great title. I mean, I keep saying that, like, as I keep talking about, like, loving the game, but I immediately fell in love with it. Like,
well, it's like a magic. It was really, it's a magic word, like, kind of, because when I went to South by Southwest, like, our friend Courtney Carlson, she had said, "Hey, you want to set up at our table at the Austin IGDA?" And I said, "Yeah, sure." So she had hooked that up, but I wasn't able to have a sign or anything. And so I just had to go wave people over to, like, the small monitor and get them to play. But, like, if I say Battlesloths, it evokes, like, curiosity at least.
Well, that's why. It's like, what? Battlesloths.
Yeah. Huh? Yeah, that's what
and
it,
it's
that's
a great,
so
and it's a, you know, it's a very unique title. It rolls off the tongue, as people would say. But even then, it's just this, it invokes something. And you're like, huh. Okay.
Say, well, why are they fighting?
Why are they fighting? It's just, well, they're fighting over pizza. Why are they fighting over pizza? Mm-hmm. And then you start like, because even you had like talked about this at the, you know, we first met or later down the line, of this like mythos of it being post-apocalyptic and
things. Now the game is
Now what's the official mythos?
The sequel is Battlesloths 2025: The Great Pizzawars, and like. I keep joking, for the price of 5 words, we have a backstory.
Yeah, and it's just joke of like the idea of like they thought it was coins or something. Like, and again, this is all just you just kind of shooting off. But like
we haven't really written anything yet. But I'm amused by the idea of pizza being like a dire resource in the future.
it's probably
some sort of like Pizza Hut chain. It was like the only thing left.
Like a Taco Bell situation from
I guess like
Demolish
Twinkies
Math.
From Zombieland would be kind of like with the parallel, but they just kind of survived it.
But I love the idea. It was such a funny, silly idea that I was like, this is invoked so much, because you could just say Battlesloths, like, what? Okay.
So I had for the game jam, right. I had John Ulrich, Ryan Liebscher, and they kind of helped out with the code. And I was directing and doing some, mostly the design stuff, and wrote a lot of the code too. And then we had like our friend Jacob, who is an artist, but he also does like cool production music and stuff. So he decided he was too backed up with another project. So he just did some music. And our friend Andy, he couldn't help out with art either. So he just kind of did some promotional stuff at the very end.
Right.
But we had Sebastian Leonard came in instead. And he was not he was a UI artist. He wasn't a game artist. So it was kind of like a Dirty Dozen sort of deal, because none of us really consider gameplay programmers or game artists.
But I think that's sort of like the allure of indie devs, is that anybody can do it. I mean, typically people that come into it have maybe, you know, gone through the fires of AAA development and sort of been there, but, you know.
Yeah, we were all AAA developers.
You know, you'd all done it before in some capacity. Then you're fine.
But he had never animated.
That's okay.
But no, he did great. No, he didn't. I'm just describing what an awesome job he did.
Yeah, no, he did. Yeah. And so then how do you land on hats then? Just because you need something to differentiate the players? Or?
So like when I started doing the core gameplay, I just had circles shooting circles at other circles. And I had no idea what it was going to look like. I didn't really think that far ahead.
Right.
So Sebastian knew about Nuclear Throne, so he just fired that up and showed that perspective. It's like, just don't care about what it looks like, the gun looks like in their hands, just rotate it.
Yep.
So that's what Nuclear Throne does. They don't really.
Yeah, they don't give a shit. Like, and that's one of the I think the endearing things is that, like, because no one, the thing about twin stick shooters, and this is the same thing I think when it comes to shmups and or shoot 'em ups in terms of like your R types and your Galagas and whatnot.
Mm.
No one's really looking at. I mean, you look at a little bit, but no one's really looking at your main sprite. No one's looking at the gun. They're keeping
like
track of the bullets
or something. You might be more concerned with what the character.
You're keeping
looks
track
like.
Of like where the hell are those bullets? Where's the pizza? Where's my reticle?
Yeah, you know? Yeah. We keep that stuff simple. So on the hats, so basically I just we were thinking like, oh, these sloughs are really cute. Sebastian had designed these like really, really funny sloughs, and the walk animation was just hilarious. and so I went home and I was thinking like, I want to dress these things up. And so I fired up GIMP and I just started making a bunch of crappy hats. and then I made a hat like system. I didn't tell the team. So the next day I come in and it's like, we're gonna do like the morning play test, and then said you can do hats now, and Sebastian just kind of like, he got super excited and then ran back. He replaced all my hats with better hats and
even better. Yeah, well, because it's one of those things that we talk about party games, and I think one of the quintessential features of a party game is the customizing of your sprite.
The sloughs are so cute in the game, and it's just like, we want to dress them up because we just want to hug them. So
that's the thing, is that like, not only does it give you the ability to make these, you know, beyond color of like, here's some differential factors for the characters that you know, like fuck, which character's mine? Oh wait, that's right, I'm in the one with the kitty hat or whatever. And,
right.
kind of have that. But it gives the player the ability to express themselves a bit. And it's
absolutely,
like,
absolutely, yeah.
You know, you see this like bizarre hat, like, oh yeah, I'm totally running with the football thing. It's like, no, screw that. I'm going with the sombrero today. And like,
yep,
that,
yep.
You know,
yeah, I mean, like, I always get the cat hat on or some stuff like that. Or like, I have a bunch of like rock and roll hats in there,
and that was what made it such a fun thing, was that, you know, because here, like, because I know anyone that's gone to the game and played it, they spend a good amount of time just looking through the hats, because they're just like,
I'm guessing people are really happy that we decided to finally put in like some sort of way to categorize it, because there's like 500 hats in there now.
Well, thank God, because like
people would like go through the list, and I just had to say like, hey, there's like a lot of hats in here. You might just want to pick one.
But that's why they're just like, they want to pick one, but it's like, I want to pick one that's me, and that's sort of what I think it makes it this really cool. Thing, and yes, it's in terms of the game mechanics, it's totally cosmetic. You know, it's not like it's gonna, you know, this has
yeah,
to
we
be
don't,
give
we
you
don't
stats.
We don't really mess with that stuff. Like, I just I think Call of Duty is a fine game and everything, but I guess I've just kind of worn out with these games that want to have like fully customizable weapons and perks and kill streaks.
I mean, I think there's a time and a place for that. I don't think party games is that, because I think the idea behind a party game is, anybody can come in, anybody can pick up that controller, and anybody can play.
I mean, all characters are equal in Battlesloths and Samurai Gun. And
right,
Powerful.
And I think that's the idea behind it, is that you come in, you make your character you,
mm-hmm.
and you play, because it's like, oh, crap, I'm out.
You pick your topping and your hat, and that's kind of it.
And I think that makes it so much fun, because if you think about a group of friends, you know, only four players can play, you have like, you know, maybe 10 people around, like, all right, cool. I'm dead. Here, you want to take next? Awesome. You're the one with this hat.
Right.
And it's like, well, can I change my hat? Like, yeah, sure, totally. We'll change your hat. And you're like, I want to be the because you already see.
Maybe I should have stat tracking for what hat gets the most kills.
That might be interesting. That might be an interesting concept.
That's feature creep.
Well, because there's such a like, and so I guess that does bring up an interesting thing. You kind of mentioned feature creep, which we should probably explain really quick. For those who are not in the development cycle of things, feature creep is the term used when a game when certain things become a little more complex than it does.
People want to keep adding features, and then it pushes out the launch of the game because you're adding
features
that are creeping in.
That things you don't really necessarily need for the
I did one this afternoon. I added force feedback to the game so that the controllers would vibrate when you shoot the guns.
Interesting. Well,
I did it in like an hour, so it wasn't too big.
Yeah,
because
it has to be built into some engine of some sort.
I used the Unity engine.
Right.
Or we used the Unity engine, and we used the rewired asset for controller input, which is like, it's amazing. I very highly recommend it. Handles multiplayer like controllers on the PC really, really well. And it also has like the force feedback stuff in there.
Yeah.
So it makes it really easy.
I would almost imagine that's not a, out of all the features you could have added, that's not a hard one to implement.
No. I mean, I'm going to have to put some stuff in to make the cat thing.
Yeah.
That's for the Patreon.
It's okay. It's
a secret Patreon.
Yeah, be a patron. You'll hear about an interesting cat. But going back to that, how do you then, especially when it comes to scope of this game, and granted it's simple in terms of, and let's not say that any game is simple, in terms of like the core mechanic, it's a very simple game. That doesn't mean doesn't take time to code, or it's not complex in coding or anything like that. I stress that because I don't want to ever come off as like the, oh, it's a simple game, it's just a platformer, it'll only take you an hour to make. Like, no, that's not how fucking it works, guys.
Yeah, I mean, it takes a lot of work to make sure it's fun. And
how do you then maintain the, I want to add this, but I also want to release the game at a certain point? I mean, now you have a date, so you have to do it.
Sometimes it's just mob rule. Like, Randy and them will be like, we're putting this in, and be like, oh man, can we like wait till after the game's out and push like this in, like post launch? So now we have to like.
It's okay. Talk what you can talk about.
No. I mean, like, well, there's like stuff. It's gonna be fine. We just need to fix some bugs on it. But we got content like that will just get tossed on my lap, and we'll just have to put it in the game. Sometimes there aren't meetings about things that are in the game for content, and
right.
Most of the time it works out, and sometimes it doesn't. So Battlesloths is kind of a great example because it's like a really big enemy.
Yeah.
And I thought it was gonna be more like a tank, like it's kind of low to the ground, like a wide, but now it's just this tall beast who like shoots lasers out of his eyes, and that's pretty rad. I mean, we're gonna get it right, but
I think that's sort of, again, like you've mentioned before, when it comes to party games, it's not uncommon to have additional content come down later, later down the line.
Preferred for a party game. I think people would enjoy that more.
Well, because I think a lot of times what keeps those games fresh is like new levels, new weapons, new game modes. Whether you're charged for or not doesn't matter, but the idea being that here's something new for that game you have already owned. It's like, oh, cool, we have a new thing, whatever, because it becomes this game that you... Because when it comes to party games, and this is sometimes the trouble part of it, I think, or the difficult part behind it, is that they typically only get played when people are over. In other words, like you think, for example, like a single player experience game, or even a multiplayer experience game, like an Overwatch or whatever.
Right.
I might play that by myself. I might play that with friends. I might play that, when people are here. Who knows? But when it comes to things like Samurai Gun or even Battlesloths or Towerfall or any of these very much party games, usually I have to have people over, and that doesn't happen all the time, especially in this gaming community.
Our game works online too.
Yeah, and that's the other thing. Well, the other point that I want to bring up that I don't see a heck of a lot of party games. I mean, there are some, but not all of them go.
Deck game does it. Deck game is online.
Oh, Deck game is online.
I thought Towerfall was online, but I think I'm wrong. I would love to see Towerfall go online.
I think it is. I think you're right. I think Towerfall is online. If it's not,
The one on PlayStation 4 doesn't appear.
I associate those games with like couch multiplayer.
Oh yeah, I mean like I would love for that to be the case. I just know that even as a developer, like it's hard for me to play the game, my own game. so unless I like knock on my neighbor's door, just, invite him over.
Hey neighbor, you want to play my indie game?
My cat doesn't know how to play games yet.
If only.
I gotta teach her.
No, you teach your cat how to play the game. Hey neighbor, do you want to come in? My cat's kicking my ass.
My cat would beat the shit out of me.
We need a third here. Bring your dog. We'll teach him too.
That's the hard part of making a party game. So I really just gotta trust my team. Like, you know, I got to trust the team back in North Carolina that when they play test, they tell me whether or not it's fun. Like, and we have bots too, but
yeah,
that bots aren't the same.
Well, because I think I think the real test has been, and this is something that, you know, you could speak to because you've been at more of these than I have, has been just the people come by con and play it. Because, like, even that, like, at MAGFest, you guys got a runner-up award, if I'm not mistaken.
For Best Presents, which is, like, the Nice Guy Award.
Okay.
I don't know if that was just meant for me or the whole team, but they liked our energy. Like, they liked that, you know, we were just kind of getting people amped, and we were just sitting and talk to them and ask, and, like, you know, take feedback. And then at one point, after hours, I had some people hanging out and said, hey, you guys must see the latest build. And so I shut down the one that I was running, and I hooked up my laptop, and I plugged in, like, a bunch of in-progress stuff, and I just started tuning weapons, like, right there. It's like, okay, well, let me speed these bullets up. I just did it right there at the convention. MAGFest is perfect for that because it's, like, a 24-hour thing.
The greatest part about that, that reminds me of there's a video somewhere of a streamer that Rami was having an interview with or doing something. He was streaming Nuclear Throne. And Rami starts, like, seeing him play and starts talking with him. And starts sending these, like, obscene builds to him.
Uh-huh.
Like, things like when a weapon, like, and Rami's mission was to see, can he break his game? So he started having, like, bullets that when they hit, they split and make another bullet. And when they hit, they make another bullet. Or it's like, when it does this, does a nuclear blast. And if it does another one. Like, it became this, like, this experiment of, like, can I break my engine? And
right.
How much can my engine take? And you know, like you're just tweaking bullets, like, I'll make this go faster. Let me make this explosion bigger. Let me do this. Let me do that.
I just put an infinite loop in, and it'll break my game just fine.
But it was such a funny thing, you know, that I think that's kind of the, you know, where you, I imagine, you, like, not just, I mean, you're not going to get, like, hardcore developer feedback of things like, well, you should tweak the UI, you may want to make the pixels a bit bigger, that kind of stuff. But
there was the stuff I wanted them to talk about, like the enemy health for, like, the Megasloth and the speed of the bullets, like how fast, like if the pickup weapons was easy, like stuff like that. Like, that's cool to be able to do that at a convention. Like, I could never do that at PAX, but I could always do that at MAGFest because there's just no... After the core hours, it's kind of anything goes.
Yeah, and there's people there that are just, like, you know, drinking and
although
having fun.
I mean, next year, I mean, if Battlesloths does well enough, I maybe wouldn't be able to do that. But
yeah, I mean, like, but even...
Unless I just had, like, a side show. Just like, hey, you can come, like, tune the game with me here.
But even that idea, like, just... I mean, obviously you get bigger, then, yeah, it becomes a sort of thing that everyone starts talking about. And then, you know, you have control and you know, a Git repo somewhere that's, like, highly privatized and locked down to no end.
Right.
But even with that, like, every time I've seen you at a convention, people have come by and been playing. Like, I played, like, once, and I'm like, oh, cool. Well, they walk around, and I'll always, like, walk by the booth to see whatever, and I'll see traffic. You'll have people doing the claws, and you have pictures, and you tweet
yeah,
out. Like,
that was kind of a interesting way that all came together. The sloths, the claws up stuff.
How did it come together? Beyond the fact that, you know, sloths have cloths,
so,
or claws.
I think it was, let's see, so Sulfur, the rapper, kind of made me, like, believe that selfies are really cool.
Yes.
Because he does the Sulfur selfie thing.
Yep.
And that was a lot of fun. And then I think I went home for a vacation, and I started listening to that band Baby Metal. Where they do, like, the kitsune hands, like,
yep,
little fox hands.
Yep.
And so I was just kind of, like, when I was on vacation, I was in my parents' living room, and I was just kind of like, I was like, oh, right, I can make a, like, a
claw. Yeah, exactly.
And then I just kind of, I posted it on Facebook and said, this is going to be the hand symbol for Battle Sloths, or you could you can do two-toed sloths if you want.
Yeah.
And then I was just, I don't know, if I forget what encouraged me to go get a selfie stick, though. But I think it might have something to do with the Sulfur selfie thing.
For sure.
And I was thinking, like selfie sticks look, like, awesome. I know people mock them a lot, but it'd be great to bring to a convention.
Yeah, no, conventions, they work out fine.
And so I just brought it with me in my bag. And then I said, you guys want to do a selfie with the developers? And everyone was super happy about it.
Well, because that's sort of the thing is that, it's rare you know, only in the indie scene do I get to meet the devs.
Yeah, probably.
And I think that a lot of gamers, a lot of people that play video games, whether they're in development or not, want to meet the guys making it because they're just like, oh, you're the guy that worked on it. Oh, cool. I have so many questions to ask. Either A, because they're interested in getting development, or B, they just are like, you know, how'd you come up with this idea? How'd you get here? You know,
yeah, I'm usually pretty good about giving advice on, like, yeah. Sometimes people be like, oh, I'm in school. What should I do?
Yeah, because
like, if I'm not too tired, I might take some time to talk about it. Or, like, listen, you know, tell a story of the game and stuff like that. I'm usually happy to do that. So, usually not a big deal.
No, and that's why. I've had zero trouble talking to indie devs about stuff and asking these sort of questions. But even then, the idea of having this, like, very branded symbol, and it seems silly just talking, like, the idea of symbols and stuff like that. But
well, it's kind of like a party thing.
Exactly. And, it becomes, you're part of a club. Like you know what this is now.
Well, it's kind of like my dream is that people will start taking sloppies without me. I won't need to be there to encourage them to do it.
Right, of course. And it just sort of becomes that. But it's...
the guys at Rooster Teeth, they were cool enough to set up, like, a little... photo booth thing for us,
which I took a picture of and put it out there on Twitter, the animated gif of it.
Yeah, so it doesn't have really I would like to put some instructions on how to do the claws up stuff.
Yeah, definitely send that down you know, to Australia, because
I think that should be going to Sydney.
Yeah, because I think, as again, it's you know, we'll kind of jump forward because we're almost out of time here. We're almost at the hour mark, which is the greatest part of the interview, in my opinion, that we got this far. Is that
We should talk about the Rooster Teeth thing if we only got
that's what I was going to kind of lead into. Is
all
that
right, I'll
like,
just get started on it.
Yeah, go for it.
We have repressed for time.
No, we still have time, but it's just, you know, we're getting close to the end.
At one point we had gotten signed. We had signed this agreement with Humble Bundle.
Right,
Humble
that's
original.
Right. Because I remember, like, you told me that it came out at one point.
I worked
some
on it. You know, we the team worked on it super super hard, and the first time we showed Battlesloths in public ever. Is at Huegos Rancheros in Austin, Texas, and
for those who don't live in Austin, Huegos is for lack of better words, one of the indie dev meetups.
There's gonna be one tomorrow night.
Right,
we might hang out with Mr. IQ.
Yeah, Mr. Chris Allen, who's also been on the show here.
Yeah, this should be fun. I'm looking forward to seeing him again.
Yeah, me too.
So I got my computer and my monitor from home and hauled my gear out, brought it upstairs, and then like the energy, like right away. Like Courtney Carlson from the IGDA, she was like taking selfies with us.
Yep.
She was just like, it blew her mind. That same night, I met Ted Anderson from Tonight We Riot, formerly known as Radical Rebels. I met John Henderson, pretty cool guy
that does
a lot of events here. And then Casey Donnellan from Rooster Teeth, he is the lead programmer on Ruby. And so he's like, oh, I think your game is like really, really fun. I think, we were thinking about publishing like indie games. Here, take my card. And I don't want this to sound like a nag or anything, because
you didn't know.
I didn't know who Rooster Teeth
was. That's why. And the thing is, you told me this when you had told me that like this was somewhat in the works and that, you know, things were kind of going down. You know, I kept in my hat and didn't say anything. I was like, I was excited as a guy that's, you know, big into Red versus Blue, Ruby, you know, Achievement Hunter, Funhouse, all these other things.
I was like,
this is a big deal that they're doing indie games, you know, as a fan. But two, I was like, yeah, you guys, yeah, that's totally no brainer. You guys are totally like Battlesloths feels like a completely like Rooster Teeth kind of ridiculous product.
So everyone there has been super, super nice and humble. And like, I mean, they're just all like great people that I met so far. So that's kind of, Casey had given me his business card, and I just left it on my desk for like 2 months.
Yeah, he's like, F.
Because I had just, we had just finished the Humble Bundle push, and I'm just like, I am spent. I'm going to lose my mind.
Yeah, you've done something.
So I didn't turn on the game for like a month or so. I mean, I fixed some like small bugs, but I was just like, I can't even like, I'm just going to take a break. And then, you know, I think Randy didn't really know them either. We looked at their site and saw, like, I didn't know Red versus Blue.
You flip on the site, see all these people there.
Well, that's the thing. Like, I was just like, I don't know what any shows are. And then they had a bunch of the Screw Attack games listed. And I was like, well, I like Angry Video Game Nerd. In fact, I really like the Angry Video Game Nerd video games.
Oh, yeah. They're really solid games, too.
So that was kind of like the only thing that I knew.
Interesting.
Their
wow.
Screwtech stuff, actually.
Yeah, because they bought Screwtech. They had purchased or sort of they now manage Screwtech assets and them as well and things like that.
Yeah. So like then Casey's like, well, let's get a burrito. Well, we got two burritos. That wasn't just one. We didn't share it like Lady and the Tramp style
or
something.
If you did, it's no big deal, you know.
Casey, next time I see you,
yeah, share a vegan burrito, Lady Tramp style.
Yeah, vegan burrito. That'd be great. And so then we, you know, got to talking, you know, about our plans for the game. And then we ended up doing RTX, and they saw like how hard we rolled at the Indie Isle, and then,
yeah, no, you guys did like that's why I was so pumped was that one A people were coming and enjoying the game, but two, you're like let's take a picture, let's do this, like you're doing everything.
Because I knew that it's basically like we know that if we put enough energy yep. and enthusiasm in the game, it's like infectious.
That's
so.
The point, and that's what endeared me to you guys was the idea of like here's a person I just. You know, randomly bumped into at a bar, lined up. Here he's doing his thing now, and it's like this is awesome, and people are liking it, and he's energetic, and he's taking pictures, he's being sociable, he's doing everything that you're supposed to do, as not just simply a developer, but as a front man, as sort of a guy that's like trying to get people to.
I guess like that's kind of like I do like a lot of like bands and stuff.
Yeah.
And but the part of like I'm not like. It's like I think it's important to have like a presence,
yeah.
an ego, but it's not like a
Well, it's important to have passion. I think it is.
Well, I think it's just kind of like I don't know, being there and just being there with the fans and stuff.
Yeah.
But you know, I guess I don't want to give some impression that I feel I'm like better than people. Or whatever.
No, like, and that's not. But that's the thing is that like.
So it's kind of like this ego where like it's like it's better job security for me if I like have the game circle us as people's,
but
like
I think
the
that,
developers.
But
and
even
stuff.
Then, I think the idea of you taking pictures and doing that kind of thing of saying, "Hey,"
I just think that I would like that if I went.
Well,
to
that's
a developer.
Why
yeah.
that's the point is I like that. I was like, "Yeah, I'll totally take a picture." Are you kidding me? That's awesome. Like, well, it's having fun, and here are people that aren't me who happen to have met you and talk with you and had a conversation with you and know the people we work with. But it's the idea that here's some random person that's not even a fan yet because they don't know what this thing is. They enjoy the game. You're like, hey, something I that worked on it. I'm trying, you know, I'd love to have a picture of you guys. Like, of course, why not? We just had a fun time playing the game.
Yeah,
here,
yeah.
Put the silly hat on. Like, awesome, silly hats. You know, and it adds to this idea of being part of something.
Oh, yeah. If you're a small-time indie, just like, get the fans pumped and
yeah.
You know, show them that you really care that they came and played the game.
And that's
and take
that's
a picture
the thing,
of them,
you know, exactly.
Like, them,
that
them,
that's sort like, of what I liked. I was like, this guy's doing it right.
It's
he
so
knows
it's
how
good
to
for social media because I think that like you take these pictures with them and then you say, follow us on Twitter so you can see your picture, and then also we'll dump it out on the Facebook.
Yeah, exactly. And you've made something personable. You've made something sort of interesting. And they've played a fun game, but they've had a they've talked with you, and they don't feel like that they're being advertised to by this, you know, big giant corporation. Like, here, have a flyer. It's
we are in fact a giant corporation.
You are now.
It's just a big.
It's a big front.
It's a big facade.
I knew it. I knew being at the pizza booth was too on brand. I knew it.
Do we have anything else we need to cover? We didn't cover talk about Middle Claws Up.
No, we didn't. We should talk about that as the last thing, because like that's also what's interesting is that like all these things like because this is the other weird connection we had is that you end up making you know music for this, but you end up getting a lot of my favorite nerdcore guys on there. And
this is another case where I didn't know who any of them were.
I am so like it's, and again, it's not even a bad thing. And I think maybe that's to your advantage, Phil. Is that you don't know who these people are, and you approach them like, "Hi, I'm small guy. I have no idea who you are, but your music sound cool. Want to do thing?"
It wasn't well,
I don't know, like
it,
that
okay,
per
so
se.
Like,
obviously, not like that. For that.
When I met Michael, like I was unemployed. I was in between jobs, so I think Michael was also unemployed then.
Yeah.
And so Randy was like, "Hey, come to the game dev meetup in Raleigh." And I was like living on the sticks. It was like an hour long drive for me to get there at this point. So I went there and got to talk and, you know, saw my friends like usual. And then Michael was there. He's dressed like he's dressed in the Michael Kill outfit, the shirt and the tie and the glasses. I'm gonna call it the Michael Kill outfit, even though it seems like he just dresses like that all the time.
That's fine.
And then his name was spelled strangely. And so I was like, "So what do you do?" He's like, "Well, I do IT and I rap." And then, you know, kind of in my head, I'm thinking like, "Well, it seems like more like the one than the other."
Yeah, you wonder like which one is he really doing these days?
Basically, as soon as I got home, I messaged Randy. I was like, "I'm super curious about your rapper friend. Can you send me a link to like his work?" And then he gave me a link to Michael's Bandcamp. And I was like, holy fuck, this guy's done like 10 albums.
Yeah.
And this is really good material. And it really kind of shed a lot of light on the nerdcore scene for me, because I felt like maybe I didn't really understand it. And then, in my opinion, like the work of Michael Kill and the other people in that track, like really kind of like helped me understand like how interesting and like diverse that scene is. But then I joked with Randy. He's like, we should get this guy to do a rap song for us. and then Randy was very matter of fact about it. He was like, yeah, we'll get a bunch of his homies on it too.
Yeah.
And I was like, really? He's like, yeah, a bunch of nerdcore guys.
Yeah, why not? Fuck it. See what happens.
So I was like, yeah, sure. Why the hell not? And I was like wanting like a giant posse cut. I wanted like a 9-minute song. and I think Michael talked me down to like a 5.5
Yeah,
minutes.
Yeah, let's just keep it 5.
We had added on Sulfur.
Yep.
Adam Warrock.
Yep.
Chesky, who's not considered nerdcore, but
he
does
matter.
A lot of Mega Man and Jesse Dangerously. You know, they all did such amazing jobs. You know, like Adam Warrock was ridiculous. Jesse was like pretty amazing. They're all really
and
good.
Rand's
like, yeah, like, well, I guess like when I started listening to these artists, I kind of gravitated towards Adam and Mega Rand the most.
That's fair.
Adam's got a really great voice.
Right.
So he's like really easy to follow.
And Mega Rand's just, you know.
Yeah.
A level of his own, you know, one of the pioneers.
He's kind of like, it's overwhelming to look at his discography. It's just a big wall.
Yeah, it is. It is, especially kind of coming in. Like, where do I jump into? And usually I point people to like, who's like, I want to get into Mega Rand. What should I listen to if I like it? Just listen to the new one. Listen to R&DM. Be fine.
Yeah, that's the one I like.
If you don't like it, then
a whole lot of the other ones.
That's fair. And again, that's why I always point them out to this one. If you don't like this, then you're probably a chance they're not liking anything
else. I really like Sulfur's Never Stop Learning song.
Right.
With the MacGyver beat on it that he did with Michael.
But
I think that's what
I like a lot about this, and if we are going to hit the hour mark like right now.
Okay.
What I like about everything that's happened in terms of Rooster Teeth publishing it, in terms of all these nerdcore guys, this everything, is that you came into this not so much of approaching these people as, oh yeah, I'd love to do this, you know, because I know these guys are. It's that, yeah, sure, why not? And you kind of you meet them. And then you hear him, because again, that speaks to me how humble of a guy you are, which, I mean, I've learned over time in terms of meeting. When I say humble, meaning that you got the deal with Rooster Teeth because, A, it's a fun game.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is the point, you know.
We weren't like, we didn't send them a
bill. Right, exactly. You didn't send them a build. You didn't, you know, not because you wouldn't have if you'd known. We're like, yeah, sure, whatever, but that kind of thing. But it was, you met these people here. You showed off the game, and it was a good game. And someone saw it and said, you know, I'd like to talk more about this. And he talked more about this, and now we're here where we are, where it's coming out very, very soon. It's is it March or February?
We're targeting March.
March.
We've got a lot of work left to do.
Yeah,
so,
that's fair.
Yeah, we'll see what happens.
You know, hopefully, one could hope by South by South, you know, South by Gaming,
yeah.
We have it. But if not, it's not, devving takes time, breaking through bugs takes time. But I love that.
A lot of us work after. Like, I'm the only one working at it full time, and it's only because my prior employer, they shut down. So.
Right. That's, again, you know, you don't.
Yeah.
But what I like about you, Phil, and is that how you, even right now at this point, you know, when you could be talking to big time, interview people.
I could be. Oh, what the hell am I doing here? I'll see you later.
All right. See you later. No, I'm kidding. if only no, but even that point, like, you know, we've conversed so many times, we've talked many times, we've hung out many times in terms of just, you know, random places, and I'm always amazed, especially when I see you at conventions, just how how willing you are to talk to fans, and how willing you are to talk to people who just walk by saying, "What's this thing here?"
Oh, I love it. You know, I spent a lot of, it's honestly like, I'm not like, it's not like my phone's ringing off the hook or whatever. I'm just usually spending my time in my apartment with my cat working on the game. And it's like, honestly, it's a little bit isolating just because I'm just doing so much work on it.
No,
and,
for sure.
You know, looking forward to like taking a vacation after this game is done and kind of be able to spend some more time with like my friends and family and stuff.
rent that cabin up on the mountain.
Yeah, I'm just gonna take a bunch of puzzles.
figure out how to begin the legend of Old Man Phil.
It's gonna be super weird. No, I'm just kidding.
but again, I'm you know, I said it before to you in you know, personally, but I'll say it publicly. I'm super excited for the game. I'm super excited for it being published with Rooster Teeth. And I'll say this publicly, even though I told you this privately, the thing that makes me most excited is that you're almost not required to per se, cause you know, you do what you want to do, but I just can't wait to see some Rooster Teeth branded hats.
I'm almost certain that we're going to have some merch, soon. I don't know when it's going to happen.
I'm ready to buy a shirt.
I will
buy a beanie.
I'll buy
a Cillipint. I mean, if it's not apparent by some of the things up there, I have like a shitload of Rooster Teeth shit now. I'll buy a keychain. I don't fucking care.
We have like a really another exciting thing in the talks, but I can't until it's really.
That's fine. Well, will you tell me privately when we're done off air? Because like, but I will say this as a fan of content and stuff, and it's been brought up by other people on Twitter. You need to make a Nora hat.
I think I would love to do that. She seems like a pleasant character.
Nora, we need a boop hat. I don't know how, but we need.
So like, I was at like people kept saying like, oh, Nora must have made this game.
And yeah,
so like,
were people saying that at the booth?
No, on Twitter.
Oh,
and then
yeah.
I asked publicly. I was like, what does that mean?
Oh, that's right, because you're not in Ruby yet.
Well, I watched season one of Ruby, but I forgot about that scene.
Yeah, I forgot about that scene too. I forgot about that too, and I was like, oh, that's right, she came up of a sloth.
Is it like a recurring joke in the?
No, it's just the one.
Ruby fans are
like anime fans in that we remember all these jokes and
well,
Rooster
I guess
fans.
That's a convenient thing about Ruby is that the episodes are so short.
Yeah, but Rooster fans in general remember silly lines like that. Like yeah, like there's a line from Red versus Blue where I think Gus's character Simmons it said like something about like I always trust my gut. And then, it's leads him wrong. It's like, stupid gut. I always remember that, like, weird way of him saying stupid gut of that. And it's not even – I don't remember what the scene is, but I remember that, like, stupid gut.
I mean, I'm sure we're going to do a sorts of, like, some sort of tie-in for Rooster Teeth stuff. I mean, it just makes sense.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, again, the hats make –
probably want, like, to put, like, what are those monsters called from Ruby?
Oh, the Grim, the
yeah,
Grim
some,
hat. Oh, my God.
I think they kind of look like sloths already.
They do. That'd be kind of interesting. Again – the hat system gives you the ability to do it, and it being this already very silly game.
Yeah, and
gives
our artist
the
wants to
it
put like 750 some hats in a game.
Yeah.
So I think we got like 200.
Then I think it's only appropriate like there's be some like a you know some RT kind of style ones of nothing more just because it's.
I'm gonna make those guys work for it. I'm gonna make them like do I don't know like I haven't figured it out yet, but I think I might do like a Twitter drive or something where the community unlocks hats by following Battlesloths. Well,
that'd be fine. Hey, do what you gotta do, man. you know, do never let me be that.
Maybe
but
Gavin can stand on his do like a headstand. For like 5 minutes.
Put a slow-mo mode in there. Oh my God, maybe that's what he's having, a slow-mo mode. That's what he needs to do.
But those guys seem like they would have a lot of fun.
Oh God, I can't wait. I honestly can't wait until you give like the build to some of the like of the people in.
The guys in Rooster Teeth Games, they said that they wanted to play it like when we sent them the early build
because I want to see Achievement Hunter play it, but I also want to see the guys at like Game Attack. That's their new brands. Basically, it's Screw Attack's kind of gaming section
now. Okay.
Because it's Craig and some of the other guys there, but you know, they tend to play a lot of like couch multiplayer stuff. They might
actually
be fun to see.
Like as far as like YouTube and streaming stuff, well, I don't really watch too much streaming for YouTubers. I just kind of watch editorial stuff like Super Bunny Hop.
That's fair.
And Jim Sterling, but I don't like his negative videos as much.
No, yeah. He's been kind of.
I like his. I like when he trashes like AAA stuff.
When he plays things he likes,
I'm okay with that.
When he plays, yeah, well, it's you know everyone has it. But regardless of that, Phil, I'm excited for the game. I cannot wait for it to come out.
I mean, we're excited to have more people get to play the game. So
that too.
You know, we're just going to keep hammering on it. And, you know, just definitely, like, engage us on Twitter. Like, you know, tag our artist slides. Just tell people that you're excited about the game. And
yeah, speaking of which, because we're already done. Thank you for being on the show. Where can people, if they want to follow the progress of this damn game?
If you can, at Battlesloths WoW on Twitter. That's the best way to get updated. And then I am Invisible Thrill. If you want to see pictures of my cat or me baking like vegan goods,
yeah, because like that was the other thing that when we met that you're like you're vegan, but like, and I missed this event because I had to work that night. But
well,
you,
I switched it. I died like 6 months ago, so it's kind of like a newer thing.
Yeah, but even then, like I missed this event that I was curious about was when you had the idea of making a vegan Philly cheesesteak.
It turned out really awesome.
Yeah. I bet it sounded like it did. I read like the Facebook post. Looks like it.
Everyone was like, yeah, it was a good time. I could do it again. That one's easier to do than like the vegan scrapple, which is something that only people from like Philadelphia would know about.
Right.
But that one takes a little bit of time. Like the vegan cheesesteaks though, it's just a matter of making the seitan and that's pretty much it.
There you go.
It's like regular meat after that.
Well, Phil, thanks for being on the show. Of course, you can find me. I'm at Vincent404. There are the Twitters. If you want to catch previous episodes of the podcast, you can go to our website, CosmicRadio.TV/8BitLife. There you'll find links to show notes, previous episodes, our Twitter account, which is at 8BitLife Podcast. And, of course, after you've given all the monies to the future of Battlesloths and you have some change left over, head over to Patreon.com/8BitLife there and help the show become bigger, better, and more awesomer.
Do Patreons get retroactive access to the secret stuff?
Yeah, they do.
There's a Easter egg in the Patreon.
There you
for
go.
This interview.
Yes, something that you'll maybe find out later on in life, but you can only get it now here.
That's right.
So that's it for the day two. Next time, talk to another geek about something completely and utterly random. Bye, people.
Claws up.